If you're interested in retro emulation like I am, then you've no doubt already come across or own one of the Raspberry Pi models. I've been using these devices as plug-and-play machines for a few years now, but I've always wanted to build a portable version of my own. Not wanting to pay inflated prices for DIY components, I tried unsuccessfully to source my own from Shenzhen last year. I plan on revisiting a DIY build in a future video after I get another chance to hit up the markets, but for now, I'm going to be focusing on arguably the best and most user-friendly RetroPie kit on the market, the DMG-inspired GPi case from RetroFlag. I'm going to be breaking this video up into a few sections in order to keep things organized, as there's surprisingly a lot to talk about with this little product. The first thing that I want to talk about with this kit is its price. I picked this up on Taobao for around $56, but you can find it on AliExpress or on Amazon for $69. You're going to need to supply your own Raspberry Pi Zero and SD card for this build. I picked up my Raspberry Pi Zero for $5 on Pi Day last year from Micro Center, but you can find these readily available on eBay for $15 or less. The SD card that I'm using is a SanDisk 64GB card, but any card that you have laying around should work. You are going to need a card of at least 16GB in order to use the image featured in this review. Aside from those, you are going to need to supply your own batteries for this case. This unit takes AA batteries, but you'll be better off grabbing a nice pack of rechargeable batteries, like Eneloops, to save money in the long run. This puts your total price tag around $116 or less depending on what you already have lying around. If you're technically inclined, you can certainly build a system for less, but you'll spend considerably more time doing so. Given that we're going to be using a pre-built kit like this with a substantial upfront cost, it's important that the unit is worth its sticker price. The build of this unit is obviously reminiscent of the original DMG Game Boy, but at a slightly smaller size. This reduced footprint means that you can easily slide this thing into your pocket if you so choose, although I would argue that it's not worth potentially doing damage to the front of your panel. Taking a look at the front of the device, we see our LCD panel, which is unfortunately only protected by a plastic screen. The screen itself is fairly bright, with brightness levels controlled by a contrast slider on the left side of the unit. The maximum brightness value will suit you just fine in any indoor situation, but you're going to have a difficult time seeing this screen in direct sunlight. At a resolution of 320x240, the IPS panel is a little bit limited, but it's as good as any display in the current competition. One final note about the display, there's a small amount of light leaking out of the right side of the panel that you will see in darkness. It's in no way as bad as the light leaks from the BitBoy that I've covered recently, and you can easily mod this in the same way to limit the amount of light coming out. The rest of the front-facing buttons are about as true to the original as possible. Our D-pad is pretty firm, but there is a decent amount of cushion when you press down. The four input buttons on the right are a little clicky, so you will probably be heard by people around you if you play this in public. Our final two buttons on the front panel are start and select buttons, and these guys are made out of a soft rubber material that is super comfortable to use. The speaker is one of the better components in this kit, pumping out sound that is of a much higher quality than any other device that I've reviewed in this channel so far. On your first installation, you may need to manually change the audio levels in the mixer in order to get some good levels out of this at max volume. Speaking of volume, you can change the audio levels on a wheel located on the right side of the unit. The following is a mic'd up recording of the audio directly from the speaker grill at medium volume. Just like the original, this unit also supplies audio out through a headphone jack on the bottom of the unit. Based on my test, the amplifier on this does a good job of delivering a full range of tones, especially in the bass frequencies. On the back of the unit, we have my favorite part of the kit itself, and that's the swappable cartridges used in this kit that I feel really set it apart from the competition. My unit actually came with two of these cartridge cases, and even though it's not really necessary or practical, I was able to install a second Raspberry Pi Zero that I had lying around with a different SD card and ROM set in that unit. There are a few use cases for something like this, but my favorite is having a different cartridge for an entirely different set of ROMs, emulators, and themes. It's hard to describe, but there's something unique about the tactile feel of using cartridges in this manner that just feels satisfying. This cartridge design also means that the system is somewhat future-proof and that this kit can be used with more powerful Raspberry Pis in the future if custom cartridges are designed to hold them. There is currently a CM3 cartridge that is being created by a developer in Taiwan that should be released soon, and that will give this device a big jump in performance. Under the cartridge slot, we have our two shoulder buttons that are essentially hidden in plain sight. These buttons have three dots on them that make them a little bit easier to find with your hands. This design choice is nice as it doesn't change the aesthetic of the device, but it does mean that it's very easy to activate one or both of these buttons unintentionally if you, for whatever reason, use this device against a flat surface. Our battery compartment holds a big cost-saving measure, as you will be responsible for bringing your own batteries for this device. I'm not going to downplay this. It's a big inconvenience, but it's no more inconvenient than it was to use the original Game Boy. You can use traditional batteries with this unit, but you're really going to want to invest in some good rechargeable batteries to save money in the long run. Based on my experience, the device seems to flash the power indicator light when it's about to die, but this could be a fluke. The downside to not having an actual battery display means that you can occasionally have the device do a dirty shutdown when the power drops below the level required to keep the system running. I didn't have access to good rechargeable batteries for most of the time that I was using this device, so I would use this in combination with a portable charger hooked up to the power jack. All of this is packaged in a design that feels robust and nice to hold. If you're someone with bigger hands, you shouldn't have too many issues getting a comfortable hold on this device, but the smaller size does mean that your fingers may feel crowded on the underside of the device. It may just be the nostalgia talking, but I really enjoy the way this thing feels in the hand, and it's very surreal playing SNES games on a device that I spent hours playing original Game Boy games on. Aside from maybe including a Pi inside the cartridge slot when you buy a unit, installation couldn't be easier. Your unit will come with a cartridge that you can pry open to reveal a PCB with pogo pins that's used to connect your Raspberry Pi Zero to the GPi case. Simply screw the PCB into the back plate of the cartridge and then connect the ribbon cable to your Pi. Close the shell around the Pi and finish by screwing the plate together. Then, it's as easy as sliding the cartridge into the device. Now, this is only half of the installation process, and one of the things that I like the most about emulation on a Pi-based system is the amount of customization options available to you. If you have spare SD cards lying around, you can experiment with pre-built images or you can create your own. For the purposes of this review, I'm going to walk you through using a community image as a means of getting something off the ground with no experience with Linux or RetroPie. The community image that I'm going to be using in this test can be found on the GPi owner's Discord, but you can also find GPi images on sites like Arcade Punks. These curated images are great because they come pre-built, and that honestly is going to save you a ton of time and setup. The image that I'm going to be using is called GPi Pegasus, and it's one of the best looking images out there. It also comes with a decent amount of games. I'm going to be using the application Rufus to image the file to the SD card. The only thing that you need to do after this is finished is to edit the Wi-Fi configuration file with your network name and password in order to have working internet on your device. You're also going to want to make a new file called SSH in order to enable SSH on the device, but this isn't really necessary if you are a complete newbie to Pi-based systems. Once that's done, you've finished the entire installation process, quick and simple. Now that we've got our image, it's time to test the system. I don't want to spend too much time on the image that I'm using, as this is a review of the unit and not the software, but I will say that this image has one of the best looking themes that I've found on the GPi. There's a good selection of ROMs for each system, including PS1, and each game has its own cover art. When we select a ROM, we have a good amount of information available. We can see the box art, description, and score. My favorite thing about these configured Pi builds is that all of the ROMs have already been scraped, which saves you a ton of time and effort. Each of the titles in this set has snaps of each game, which shows you a preview of the title before you launch it. Raspberry Pi Zero performance is pretty well documented, but for the uninitiated, we can take a look at a few titles from several systems included in this image to give you a good idea of what you can expect from this unit. I want to start things off with PS1, since there were a ton of comments about this particular Raspberry Pi on my RG350 video. Performance here is much better than you'd expect with a Pi Zero. You're obviously not going to be able to play everything in the PS1 library due to limited controls, but this image does show that a lot of things do run without issues using the correct emulator and settings. Regardless, this image includes enough good titles to keep you busy for some time. The real retro systems like the NES and SG-1000 don't really pose much of a threat to the power of the Pi Zero, neither do the handheld systems like GB, GBC, Game Gear, and the like. Be forewarned, however, there are no Pokemon games in this collection, so you will need to add your own. Older arcade titles also shine on this system with little issues, assuming you're playing games that are compatible with the emulators. These can be a little hit or miss from title to title, which is why these curated sets are so important. The performance limits of this system really shows in how inconsistent it is in emulating GBA and SNES titles. The ones included in this image run without issue, but you may need to swap out emulators on launch for titles that are not compatible with the default configuration. One of the things that I really love about this system is its compatibility with Bluetooth controllers for two-player games. Although the screen isn't that big, it does work well for some co-op on the go. Using an 8-bit Duo SN30 Pro, I'm able to connect via Bluetooth and map a second controller inside the menu. After that, all you need to do is fire up a two-player game and you should be good to go. If this isn't your style, you can always try to netplay two Pis together. I can't complete a review on the GPi case without comparing it directly to other retro consoles that share its Game Boy-inspired design. The BitBoy version 3.5 that I recently did a review on and the RG300 are perfect candidates for this, as these are both consoles that many people already own. In terms of general ease of use, both the BitBoy and the 300 have the Pi beat hands down. These are consoles for the masses and as such tend not to be too complicated. Using a pre-built image alleviates some of this difficulty, but you're really going to want to learn how the system works so you know how to make changes when things don't. Both of these consoles also went out in the size category too, with both of them able to easily fit in pretty much any pocket with no issue. While the GPi is in no way hindered by its size, the bulk of the device does mean that it cannot be as easily packed away as my stow-and-go BitBoy. Once we move past aesthetics, however, the real qualities of the GPi case shine. Right off the bat, the first thing that you're going to notice is the image quality in these displays. The GPi case seems to have the highest brightness value out of any of these units, but the darker tones are more washed out than they are on the IPS panel in the RG300, with the added benefit of having a glass screen. The RG300 also seems to be a tad bit sharper than the GPi, but it's honestly too hard to tell. Both the GPi and RG300 have better speakers than that of the BitBoy, with the added benefit of having none of the static noise, but the max volume of the RG300 is about 30% of the volume on the GPi. In terms of overall feel while playing, the RG300 and GPi are pretty much the same, but the GPi's faster processor means that it's less likely to experience slowdowns during play. The one place where the GPi just simply cannot compete with these other two units is in its startup time. The GPi, like other Pi-based systems, is laughably slower than the open Dingux systems. You will need to be patient with a device like this, and whether or not the wait time is worth it is entirely up to you. So to wrap things up, the creators of the GPi case have succeeded in making a Pi-based case for the average Joe. With the GPi case, you can go from open box to gaming system in under 30 minutes with very little work. The system is a modern rendition of a classic icon that is sure to turn heads in public, and its processor means that a great deal of retro titles can be at your fingertips at any time. The system suffers from a lack of a battery and screen protection, but it makes up for that with a great feeling case and amazing controls. I would love to see a version of the GPi case inspired by the Game Boy Pocket, as I think that would make a killer device for any handheld collection. My name is Taki, and I've been your host on this review. If you like what you saw here, please consider leaving a like and subscribe to the channel if you haven't already. I base a lot of what I do on this channel from viewer feedback. If I miss something that you want addressed, or you have suggestions for things that you'd like to see me review in the future, please don't hesitate to leave a comment below. I'll catch you next time for another review of a retro system. Now go out and enjoy the rest of your day. Taki out.